Just a brief apologetic or clarificatory note. My take on roadblocks doesn't have anything to do with space, although I'm in this panel. My conception of a roadblock is purely temporal. So what I will be talking about is really historical imagination, and particularly the historical imagination of the left. And my argument will focus on a roadblock that is not usually considered a roadblock at all, and which is the very conception of the future. In a bold and ambitious essay that he published a few years ago, Kojin Karatani argued that one could make a scientific case for the phenomenon of historical repetition and claimed Marx as the first thinker of a repetitive structure in history. There are at least two structures of historical repetition in modernity, Karatani contended, and both of them actively and seriously preoccupied Marx. Repetition at the level of the state, a phenomenon that lies at the core of Marx's analysis in the 18th Brumaire, and which concerns the cycle of state transformation from empire to nation and back to empire, and repetition in capital, which concerns the phenomenon vital for Marx's capital, of periodic crises of capitalist accumulation. On the basis of plotting the interplay between these two types of repetition, Karatani proceeds to map the world's historical stages of state capitalism by suggesting that a more or less regular pattern of alternation between liberalism and imperialism as dominant modes of global economic policy can be traced in the 60-year intervals that punctuate the period between 1750 and 1990. This periodization, in turn, tends to render visible a third type of repetitive structure, revolution. For as Karatani suggests, quote, counter-movements against the state and capitalism have changed in accordance with the world's historical stages of state and capital, unquote, and thus exhibit parallel patterns of recursion. 1848 and 1968, emerging exactly 120 years or two 60-year cycles apart from each other, are both civil society revolutions, ones that do not put on the agenda the prospect of seizing state power. They are, Karatani argues, both type B revolutions, the kinds of revolution that emerge during liberal stages in capitalist expansion. 1789 and 1917, on the other hand, separated by some 128 years from each other, are both state revolutions, ones that focus on taking hold of and transforming state power. Constituting type A revolutions, they correspond to imperialist stages of capitalist development and tend to either immediately precede or immediately follow upon war. Indeed, they mark moments of passage between international and civil war. If revolution, however, also tends to submit itself to a law of historical repetition, and let us remember that one of the original meanings of revolution since the late Middle Ages is precisely that, quote, the return or recurrence of a point or period of time, so does counter-revolution. Indeed, and though Karatani doesn't dwell on this, this is one of the fundamental preoccupations of the complex metaphorics of the opening pages of the 18th Brumaire. For when Marx writes of Luther donning the mask of the Apostle Paul, or, quote, the revolution of 1789 to 1814 draping itself alternately as the Roman Republic and the Roman Empire, and of the revolution of 1848 as incapable of doing anything but parodying, quote, now 1789, now the revolutionary tradition of 1793 to 1795, end of quote, he's writing not of parodies or travesties of revolutions, but of real, actual revolutions. If the famous opening lines on Hegel and on the repetition of tragedy as farce are to be taken as bearing on Luther, the French Revolution, and the revolutions of 1848, then surely parody in these cases is a very different phenomenon than in the case of the counter-revolutionary coup of Louis Bonaparte, which constitutes the main subject of Marx's polemic. In the former case, repetition is a phenomenon clearly linked to the authentic anxiety inspired by revolution. I quote Marx.
just when they seem engaged in revolutionizing themselves and things, in creating something that has never yet existed, precisely in such periods of revolutionary crisis, they, human beings, anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service and borrow from them names, battle cries, and costumes in order to present the new scene of world history in this time-honored disguise and this borrowed language. In the wonderful counterintuitive inversion of this passage, the spirits or ghosts of the past, what Marx calls the dead of world history, are not causes of anxiety. They are protective measures against anxiety. Anxiety does not originate in them, in the realm of conjured spirits. It originates in the realm of revolution as an act of, quote, creating something that has never yet existed, of revolutionizing both things and oneself. There is very little sense in seeing the repetition inherent in revolution, the repetition that is here depicted as a necessary and inevitable means of shoring up the courage to go through with revolution, as an idle farce. If farce is involved at all, it is as a constitutive dimension without which the tragic grandeur of Luther's Reformation, of 1789, of 1848 would have been impossible. But then why speak of farce in the first place? Marx makes clear that he deploys the word purely within the context of the ironic work of the Hegelian ruse of reason. The ghosts of the past inspire real, tragic heroism, but do so only as long as such heroism remains necessary for the bloody foundation of modern bourgeois society. They quickly disappear when the new, banal reality of the power that has thus been constituted reveals its true face. To the extent that it can be deployed as a way of thinking the recursive element in revolution, farce is then not a result of repetition as such, but rather of the fact that such repetition, in inspiring heroism and courage against the anxiety of the new, also serves to hide from historical actors, and quite specifically from the bourgeoisie, the true, pedantically pragmatic nature of their struggle. I quote Marx, "Unheroic as bourgeois society is, it nevertheless took heroism, sacrifice, terror, civil war, and battles of peoples to bring it into being. And in the classically austere traditions of the Roman Republic, its gladiators found the ideals and the art forms, the self-deceptions that they needed in order to conceal from themselves the bourgeois limitations of the content of their struggles and to keep their enthusiasm on the high plane of the great historical tragedy." The case is very different when it comes to the farce of counter-revolutionary repetition. Whereas Marx clearly and unambiguously states that in the case of revolution, quote, "the awakening of the dead served the purpose of glorifying the new struggles, not of parodying the old," he proceeds to remark that after 1848, a disastrous mutation regarding the very import of historical repetition has taken place. Quote, "From 1848 to 1851, only the ghost of the old revolution walked about. From Marast, the Republican Jean, who disguised himself as the old Bailly, down to the adventurer who hides his commonplace repulsive features under the iron death mask of Napoleon. An entire people, which had imagined itself an accelerated power of motion, suddenly finds itself set back into a defunct epoch, and in order that no doubt as to the relapse may be possible, the old dates arise again, the old chronology, the old names, the old edicts, which had long become a subject of antiquarian erudition, and the old minions of the law who had seemed long decayed." The contrast between these lines and the ones preceding them can hardly be overstated. If in the cases of Luther, 1789 and 1848, the awakening of the dead was intended as a means of finding, quote, "the spirit of revolution, not of making its ghost walk about again," in that of the period after 1848, revolution has effectively been reduced to a ghost of itself. The people regress into a defunct epoch. The resurrection of the old dates, the old chronology, the old names, and so forth, becomes a telltale sign of bourgeois decay. Napoleon, the emblematic figure of what we could call Taipei revolutionary repetition, is reduced to an iron death mask that hides the commonplace, repulsive features of his entirely despicable nephew. Counter-revolution, in other words, transforms the very nature of repetition and constitutes a second, noxious type of recursion. Whereas repetition originally was a means of withstanding the anxiety of the new and unknown, it now becomes an end in itself, a roadblock against historical progress. The death mask, to which the nephew reduces his uncle, is the dialectical opposite of the masks Luther, Cromwell, Robespierre, Danton, or Napoleon wore. Whereas in their case, the seizure of past glory serves as a guarantee of renewal and revitalization of revolutionary energy in the present, in the case the coup makes apparent, it has become the sign of a reactionary reification, of a deadening of the past, which truly can be said to now weigh, in the famous phrase, like a nightmare on the brain of the living. What these dense and remarkable pages make clear then is, first, that revolution and counter-revolution are both phenomena predicated on repetition, but constitute clearly different, in fact opposed, versions of the compulsion to repeat. And secondly, that for Marx, the fusion of heroism and parody that defines the bourgeois epoch of revolutionary repetition is over. For with the second Napoleon, the bourgeoisie confirms its terminal transformation into a reactionary, counter-revolutionary class. The period between 1848 and 1851, in other words, reveals the emergence of an irreversible change as regards the political import of repetition. And it is precisely in the context of this diagnosis that you can no longer repeat in a revolutionary manner, that henceforth all repetition is counter-revolutionary. It is in this context that Marx concludes his introductory description of the impotent senility of French society in this period with the following famous remark. The social revolution, I quote, of the 19th century cannot draw its poetry from the past, but only from the future. It cannot begin with itself before it has stripped off all superstition in regard to the past. Earlier revolutions required recollections of past world history in order to drag themselves concerning their own content. In order to arrive at its own content, the revolution of the 19th century must let the dead bury their dead. My contention in this essay is that our contemporary, largely academic left, and I'm referring particularly to the Western left in the period between the late 1960s and the present, has severely misunderstood and distorted the import of these words. It has done so because it has tended to detach them from the complex and dialectically inflected context in which they are embedded. The result has been the reification of the factor of novelty in thinking the reality of revolutionary processes, and reversely, the equation of any and all kinds of recursion with reactionary, indeed counter-revolutionary politics. This stance, which in my view has had disastrous consequences in our own conjuncture, has of course gained much of its legitimacy from a reading of Marx from the standpoint of a certain modernist ethos, that of making it new, which as a variety of our more perceptive critics and philosophers, for instance Jameson or Badiou, have discovered, is not that easy to distinguish from the spirit of capitalism itself. A revolution has become just another of the instances of a fetishization of novelty, which converts the new into precisely the content of automatism and repetition, of the total and surreptitious war against any genuine change. Hence, the subtly dialectical nature of the Brumaire's understanding of repetition as both fundamental to revolutionary self-fashioning and as symptom of a counter-revolutionary turn has largely been ignored, along with a specific historico-political reason why Marx is willing to suggest that it will no longer be possible for future evolutions to draw their poetry from the past. It is not simply that in his eyes the bourgeoisie is exhibiting signs of historical decay, of incapacity to engender any further social progress, a matter practically disputed by much of the post-1960s left barely hidden admiration for the kind of resilience 20th century post-war, post-Fordist capitalism exhibited. It's not just that. It is also that in 1952, when Marx was writing these lines of the 18th Brumaire, the proletariat from which he was expecting a new kind of revolution was only 8 years old, having been discovered by no other than himself around 1844, when he was writing the preface to his critique of Hegel's philosophy of right. One could hardly expect this radically new social actor to be able to draw the poetry of its own social revolution from the past at the time the 18th Brumaire was being written. But it would be equally illogical to expect that the same directive could and should have been valid 60 years later, when Lenin would return almost compulsively to the experience of the 1871 commune in a series of writings which span the years 1907 to 1919 and which confer upon it the status of a model and prototype for the dictatorship of the proletariat and the Soviet Revolution. One can imagine few interpretations of Marx's supposed equation of proletarian revolution with the abolition of repetition as absurd as one that would end up declaring that Lenin and the Soviets were mere parodies of Marx and the Paris Commune. Yet it is indisputable that they were very much consciously donning their masks and explicitly draping themselves in the mantle of their revolutionary legacy and crossing the borders of national history for that purpose. Then, of course, there is the rather awkward fact that Marx himself waged serious war against attempts to reduce proletarian revolution to idle futurology. To the Brumaire's 1852 presumably absolute directive against drawing the poetry of future revolution from the past, one should not neglect to compare the German ideology's 1845 resounding assertion. Quote, "Communism is not for us a state of affairs which is to be established, an ideal to which reality will have to adjust itself. We call communism the real movement which abolishes the present state of things. The conditions of this movement result from the now existing premise." Nor should one forget that in the 1871 writings on the Paris Commune that were to prove so important for Lenin in 1917, Marx noted, "The working class have no ready-made utopias to introduce par décret du peuple. They have no ideals to realize, but to set free the elements of the new society with which all collapsing bourgeois society itself is pregnant." Marx then is not at all, at least if we accept that he is minimally consistent, advocating vulgar futurology when he suggests that henceforth revolutions should draw their inspiration from the future. The future of which he speaks is not at all a neutral, calendrical dimension. It is not, as Benjamin would remark in an essay in which he attacked the social democratic character of futurological solace, homogeneous, empty time. Marx's future is at one with the working class in and for itself. To put it directly, the working class is that future. But this also means that in no way does the Brumaire prohibit future evolution, as long as it remains world historical, and therefore necessarily proletarian in nature, from drawing upon the proletariat's own and in 1852 as yet unformed past. From the perspective of the mid-19th century, a properly proletarian past to draw upon can only be something that will emerge as a past from the standpoint of the future of working class struggle. The poetry of the new kind of social revolution that Marx is envisioning in 1852, the revolution that will break the demonic spell of counter-revolutionary parodies of the Bonapartist type, will be drawn from a future that includes, for instance, the 1871 commune. It is a future that, from the standpoint of the revolution of 1917, is of course the usable proletarian and revolutionary past. I have suggested that the contemporary Western left has long been blind to the kinds of issues posed by a careful reading of the opening pages of the Brumaire. And I tend to think that this blindness has much to do with the triumph around the late 60s, and indeed around the largely cultural and theoretical revolution of 1968, of what one could term the discontinuity thesis. One of the sites to which it can be traced is the bitter and prolonged dispute between working class historiography and structuralist Marxism, which in the case of the UK and the British New Left extends from 1964 to 1980 and the Thatcherite counter-revolution. I do not have the time to say virtually anything of substance concerning this dispute, but I think it remains highly significant for at least one reason. The polarization between agency and structure effectively mirrors the polarization between the working class itself and the new, largely academically centered social movements of the late 60s, so that to privilege structure over agency and discontinuity or rupture over continuity and experience was also in effect to displace the working class itself as a social subject adequate to the tasks of a revolution to come. A revolution of which now nothing could be known but its mystical and quasi-messianic novelty, its complete detachment from the structure of repetition that had therefore both engendered and limited all preceding revolutionary innovation. How much time do I have left? Okay. It is obviously impossible to provide extensive evidence of the saturation of the contemporary common sense of the academic left by reified and undialectical futurology in any systematic manner, so allow me to conclude by referring to a number of the symptoms of the futurological roadblock exhibited by a prominent and relentlessly vocal figure of this left, Slavoj Žižek. In an essay that appeared in the London Review of Books, and in the context of rehearsing all the well-worn platitudes on the general intellect and immaterial labor that have become de rigueur after Negri and Hart's empire, Žižek confidently proclaimed that most of today's strikes are held by what he terms a salaried bourgeoisie, and thus are not proletarian protests, but, quote, protests against the threat of being reduced to proletarians. Yet at the time these words were published, and in my native Greece, the steel workers of Attica were already in the 12th week of a mammoth strike, which was to last for 272 days and become the longest workers' strike in the history of contemporary Greece. In the meantime, workers at a recycling company in Crete would succeed in having their demands met after 118 days of striking, whereas the anything but bourgeois workers at the post-Fordist services of the phone marketing company would wage a 114-day-long and victorious strike from March to July, all with Communist Party organizational support. At the end of July 2012, an Irish anarcho-syndicalist website bitterly remarked that when Žižek came to Greece in early June to address a coalition of the radical left Syriza rally, he didn't bother to pay a visit to the still striking steel workers just a few kilometers away, who were then past the seventh month of their strike. It would be strange if he had. Not only did he infamously remark in the same rally that the Communist Party of Greece, which was the main organizational force behind the steel workers, is a party that is still alive, quote, only because it has forgotten to die. But he spent much of the previous year flirting with a new social movement he discovered that occupied Wall Street, which he addressed with the following surely reassuring words. We are not communists. If communism means a system which collapsed in 1990, the only sense in which we are communists is that we care for the commons. The commons of nature, the commons privatized by intellectual property, the commons of biogenetics, for this and only for this. And only for this, we should fight. The working class does not exist. Communist parties are zombies of the past. Contemporary capitalism has nothing to do with the one Marx or Lenin analyzed and fought against. Strikes are a bourgeois affair. Salvation from the capitalist dead end has the shapeless form of a vague to come that will, in all events, reflect the ultra-modernity of new social subjects. This is the gist of the futurological chatter that poses as critical knowledge today. At the antipodes, there is the discourse produced by the strikers themselves, a discourse that vitally concerns the struggles of the present as mediating points in an open-ended continuum between past and future. The worker who states in a November 2011 article on the strike that strikers are not willing, quote, to lose what our forefathers gained with their blood. the leader of the workers' union, Yorgos Sifonios, stating in the last of the strike meetings that the union struggles to preserve, quote, the rights obtained by our forefathers. A worker wife stating, quote, that our children are proud because their fathers have not bent their heads down. End of quote. The Steelworkers Communist Union in Magnesia proclaiming that workers are fighting so that, quote, their children will not become 21st century slaves. Or the silent but eloquent image in a recent documentary on the 1 year anniversary of the strike of a commemorative book on the Larco factory strike of 1977, donated to the strikers in Attica by an anonymous laborer and containing the handwritten dedication, quote, as long as there is capitalist exploitation, there shall be worker solidarity. Remaining deaf to the complex dynamics of actually existing and long persisting working class struggles, degenerating into a banal, short-lived celebration of whatever happens to claims the status of a novelty, the contemporary academic left has abandoned the terrain of repetition to the monopoly of counter-revolutionary deployment. While Zizek and his kindred in the academic left are engaged in the eternal pursuit of an immaculately conceived revolution to come, that on closer inspection turns out to rehash all the stock footage of social reform and social democracy, state capitalism is busily demolishing the last vestiges of working class victory in the previous century. The enemy everyone swears they're fighting, at least, is not at all ashamed to repeat the repressive strategies and tactics of its own forefathers, including, of course, the shameless reanimation of the only superficially dormant monster of fascist terrorism. It has left the quixotic pursuit of historically deracinated, groundless alternatives to those dedicated to regaling us with parodies of the Brumaire itself. But it is time that this already overripe farce was over and done with.